Since the formal establishment of Duke Medicine in 1930 by the Duke Endowment, with the mission to improve healthcare in the Carolinas, the history of Duke Medicine has become synonymous with leadership in medicine. This rich history is best described by Duke President Richard Broadhead. When Duke was founded as a university, it had a dream, which was, how can you take your regionally admired North Carolina Liberal Arts College and make it a world-class research university? It took a certain strategic intelligence, and Duke University President William Preston Few had the idea to make this place known and then to have it be the substance of world-class excellence. He made two moves. He hired the football coach from the University of Alabama because sports teams carried a name further and faster than anything else, and also decided to make a world-class medical school on a place that had been a forest and pig farm. And both guaranteed the success of this university. Duke is now famous for many things, but wherever it is known for the quality, history, and tradition of Duke Medicine, a tradition that is excellence in leadership.
Because Duke is a leader among those excelling in scholarship, but Duke is truly, to me, unique as an institution that's saying being the leaders, scholars is not enough. We want to be scholar doers in terms of translating what it is that we excel in into real world experiences and real world life improvements.
Duke's place as a leader in medicine has its foundation in the rich history of its values, among them excellence, safety, integrity, diversity, and the value of the team.
You have to learn to work with each other in a common purpose. And I haven't found that with too many institutions. But Duke is unique, and I hope we do not lose that feature in the future, because it's the way you get that done.
You know, the thing that I like most, I think, about Duke Medicine is I view it as a team. I think my role as a head of a football program is the same with our leadership in Duke Medicine. You're not going to be very good individually in any big operation. The only way you're going to be outstanding is to have a great team.
There are, in my opinion, in every place, you have talented people who have all the right passion. So the key in leadership is how to draw the very best from these individuals and how to create the opportunity for them to express and realize their passion and value. I think at the end of the day, it is really the culture of continual leadership. Someone at all different levels is thinking about how to do the right thing, how to make things work. That's really quite amazing in shaping Duke's culture.
The principles which have served as the building blocks of Duke medical leadership, excellence in delivering quality patient care, innovative research, and education and training have been intertwined into the fabric of its collective spirit since the inception of the medical school by its founding dean, Dr. Wilbur Davison.
The leadership, the integrity, the cohesiveness, the commitment, it was ever apparent. I mean, you couldn't escape it.
I would start off by saying probably the two or three driving forces that developed the culture, you'd have to start with Darrell Hart. And so Dr. Hart came down from Hopkins, which had a very regimented program. Dr. Hart saw the importance of developing not just the clinical programs, but the basic science programs, and so the culture that had been established by Dr. Hart, of course, it flowed quite naturally to Dr. Saviston. But Dr. Saviston took it more in the direction of academics. Dr. Saviston became the premier chairman on the continental shelf. There's no doubt about that.
Well, I think he attracted good people. Major, major personality. World famous guy. Took care of his own people, had high expectations, and you set the expectations and your troops will meet it.
And so these two men, Dr. Sabiston and Dr. Stead, I think were without a doubt the two premier physicians in the United States at that time, Dr. Sabiston in surgery and Dr. Stead in internal medicine. We had they were very, very strong departments. A little bit unlike today, where at that time the departments ran the hospital, ran the medical school. They ran everything.
It is a department where you support and celebrate all missions equally, and that is the clinical mission, the research mission, the education. It's all part of what makes the Department of Medicine great. That goes back probably 50 years to the leadership of Feagin. So he really introduced the concept and practice of evidence-based medicine even before it was called evidence-based medicine. But the idea that to practice really high-quality clinical medicine, you had to understand the science behind it.
Because curiosity, learning in depth, was his main emphasis. And the idea was that there was no patient that was boring or uninteresting. So the rigidity of hierarchy and labels and titles was not something he paid any attention to. The question was the person motivated? And character of the individual was key. He assumed people would know things, but what was their character? Were they honest, trustworthy, open? Were they capable of perseverance, hard work?
Built in the vision of these titans of medicine and surgery, Duke has experienced remarkable growth in the breadth and depth of its mission, while holding close to its core values during an incredible time of transition and transformation in medicine.
Duke Hospital was built on a platform of excellence. If you go back through the years and look at what prior leaders have said, the Bill Anlians of the world, the Dr. Davidsons, you know, all of the people who were leaders here at Duke Medicine, one word that is always there, it's about excellence.
I would say that I think our leaders have appropriate respect for the past, but they also look to the future, and so I'll elaborate a little bit. There are some places where leadership respects the past so much that you're hindered by the past, that you can't move forward because you're paying so much homage that you can't actually think progressively. We are blessed by an entrepreneurial spirit here at Duke, I think because we're a relatively young institution. So we get to look back and enjoy the past and respect the past, but we're always looking forward.
In more recent times, one Duke leader, Dr. Ralph Snyderman, led a significant transformation of Duke University Health System and secured Duke's continued relevance in today's healthcare environment.
And one of the general principles that I learned as a leader, or trying to be a leader, is that you never listen enough and you never communicate enough. You could always do more.
He was a remarkable chancellor. And he converted the place from a world-class research institution to a world-class research / health system. And he oversaw this amazing expansion of the healthcare system without losing anything on the research side, which I thought was a remarkable achievement.
One of the stories about Duke that I was very impressed with the power of leadership. And Duke had a very traumatic mishap where there was a transplant that was a mismatched organ into a young woman, and it was very visible publicly. And I was so impressed with how Duke leadership handled what was a very painful experience. And Bill Fulkerson was president of Duke Hospital, I believe, at the time. And what I was impressed was the willingness to go out to the public and say, we made a mistake, and these are all the things we're going to do to redouble our efforts to make sure that we don't make mistakes in the future. And it was very striking how that willingness really allowed both the public as well as Duke to go forward in an event that was really tragic.
Unfortunately, we all make mistakes. Some are more serious than others, but I think when serious mistakes are made, I think that it's extremely important for the leaders in an organization, for others in the organization to admit they made mistakes. Because without doing that, without surfacing that truth about things in your organization or to whatever constituency is important about that, I don't think you'll ever correct it. I think you'll repeat it.
The ability to change and adapt remains a constant requirement, and today's leaders in Duke Medicine embody this quality as they address today's healthcare challenges and seek to define the future.
From a leadership perspective, I think we always have to be reminded of the power of those informal interactions. Leadership, in my view, is not really about some sort of hierarchical process. It's about how do you have relationships with people and effectively get things done in sort of more informal fashion.
But I think in this complex world, having that more distributive leadership where you empower others to collectively accomplish the mission or the goal of patient care, I think that's more effective.
The bigger the idea, the bolder the idea, the more aggressive the idea, the higher likelihood that it's going to happen. Small ideas in Duke Medicine that have small incremental change in a system, really, they don't go far. But big, bad ideas, this is the place to be.
The value of different perspectives has become increasingly recognized in medicine, whether that be gender, profession, or social background. The deans of the School of Medicine and Nursing share their experiences on the importance of maintaining medicine-based leadership in the healthcare of tomorrow.
Women are still underrepresented in medicine in general, particularly in some specialties, and underrepresented in leadership positions in medicine. And I think that the way that that's going to change is by bringing in more women leaders and increasing the critical mass, and recognizing that women bring great value to leadership and sometimes have perspectives that are different from what men have, but complementary. And I think the goal, obviously, at the end of the day, is to have the same kind of diversity in medicine that we have in all aspects of our real lives.
I think it takes all kinds. I think it takes people from business. I think it takes people from law. But if you don't have some key expert clinicians at the table, you're not going to be making good decisions. There's no question in my mind.
We always have to remember why we do what we do. And I think that is quite unique. And I've always considered that the honor of being in medicine, that you are privileged to provide a very intimate service to people. And everything else that we do eventually can be distilled to that.
We have seen that the history of Duke Medicine has provided a foundation of excellence, and the medical leadership principles of patient-centeredness, integrity, critical thinking, emotional intelligence, teamwork, and selfless service show us a path for the future. Throughout this incredible transformation of medicine over the past century, our culture and values hold steady as we embark upon a bright future in medicine, here at Duke and around the world.
Well, the message to the new group of leaders for Duke Medicine is pretty much the message the old group of Duke leaders had, and that is You know, first of all, be excited about the opportunity to lead. You've been given a tremendous opportunity, not just to be someone who's outstanding in medicine, but someone who's outstanding in the leadership of medicine. What an amazing impact you can have on people, on the medical profession. It's an incredible opportunity. Just remember to be adaptive. You're always dealing with new people. You know, cultures change, values don't. Values should be embedded. And how you teach them, how you lead people to follow those, to do those values, changes a little bit in strategy as you go forward.